Hi, I'm Gerald, and so today we're from Inzen. We're a Singapore-based developer, and we also do incubation programs in Southeast Asia as well. Today we have a very interesting panel. Just to give you a bit of background, typically panels cover what it's like to operate as a publisher. We thought it'd be quite interesting this round to cover it from what is it like as a developer working with a publisher, and also what is it like for some of the publishers to share their stories in what's worked and what hasn't worked for them. So I'll introduce our panel. First we have, and maybe they can come up, first we have Pattera, who's the CEO of Ini3. We also have TT, who's the country manager of Gameview. Quang, co-founder and COO of Appota. And Ang, who's the director of BD for Mind Games. I'll leave the panelists to do a short intro themselves, but we have a very interesting panel because... okay, yes, we do with the... Yes, with the face. Okay. So... Yeah, just to give a quick overview, we have a very interesting mix because we have Pattera, who's been, the company's been around for a very long time, very established in Thailand, come from PC online to mobile, and very strong base in Thailand. And then we have TT, whose personal career was from PC online, and then moved to mobile. And they also have a very strong base in Malaysia, reaching to Southeast Asia. And then we have Ang, who interestingly enough, she's from Vietnam, but works with Mind Games in Indonesia, and she comes from a background of mobile publishing from Vietnam, right? And then we have Quang, who's from one of Vietnam's most successful platforms and publishers, and they've gone from being a platform to a publisher. So we'll have some very interesting, I think a very interesting spread of stories to hear from today. So maybe I'll move on to Pattera first to give an introduction of Ini3.
Okay, so thank you very much and good afternoon, everyone. Ini3 is it's a publisher company based in Thailand, and we have been in the business for 12 years. So we grow from Korean PC game back in the old day that people were playing PC game with a subscription model, and we were the first one who introduced the free-to-play item selling models in Thailand. And then business go on until 2009, we launched the first browser-based game, and it's very successful. And in 2013, it was the first year that we started launching mobile game. So a lot of try and error, and then finally we make quite a huge success in 2014. And then beginning of this year, we help Blizzard Activision to launch Hearthstone in Thailand. So we're like the first official local publisher that Blizzard has choose to work with. Yeah.
Very cool. Thank you, Pattera. TT.
Good afternoon. My name is TT. I'm from Gameview. We are the mobile game publishers that are currently serving the Southeast Asia. So we started with the web games earlier days, and we shifted from mobile games since two, three years ago. And currently we have our most active areas is mainly like Malaysia, Singapore, Thailand, Indonesia, and Vietnam as well. So we also do publish game globally for different of languages like German language or even some French language. So, and in terms of mobile games nowadays, we still have a lot of new stuff that going to launch by this year. Is some platform for online, probably like comics and everything that related to games and IP. Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Titi. Ang?
Good afternoon. My name is Ang. I'm from Vietnam, and but today I'm not representing any Vietnamese publisher, but for Indonesian publishers. My company is already operated in Indonesia for 5 years. Start from PC games, client, and web, and we moved to mobile just a year ago. The biggest success for us until now is we are still there. Why a lot already gone? The market is very tough. We only have a branch, only have office in Jakarta, but we try to attract the talent in regions. So right now we have Chinese, Vietnamese, Malaysian, and Indonesians in our office. And we self-service in globally, regionally, and mostly in Indonesia.
Thank you, Aang. Quang.
Hi, everyone. I'm Quang, co-founder and CEO of Appota Vietnam. We are the mobile distribution platform for support for developer and publisher from all around the world to come to publish game and app in Vietnam from 2012 until now. So we're starting with the platform, but the first business is the distribution. And then we're moving to the publishing game and provide the advertising service with the local payment provider as well. So in January, we had the A to Z service for the one game which to want to come to into Vietnam market, from localization, customer care operation support, for PR, marketing, what else, whatever, and then even the affiliate network for everybody want to try. So far, we consider as a top three publisher, local publisher in Vietnam. And Vietnam is a very quite hot gaming market in South Asia. So far, if you want to join, just ask me free advice.
Thank you. Okay, so we have two parts to this panel. The first part really is a little bit of like setting the context, right? What is it like to work with these publishers? Perhaps they'll share a bit of their network reach, what regions they're active in, their sourcing criteria, some expectations to have when working with them. And the next part of the panel actually talks about, they'll share thing that they've thought would work out, thought would be successful, but was not successful. And they also share some games that may have been, they thought, oh, that wouldn't work out, but were runaway hits. So we'll get to hear some interesting stories here. So maybe I'll get Pattera to share the first part. So with INE3, what's it like to work with INE3? What regions are you active in? What regions are you actively sourcing from? And what terms, do you work with?
Our home is Thailand, and Thailand is, I think, comparing with Vietnam, so we're like the two countries that's probably largest in Southeast Asia. So all of my experience, like, it's pretty much based in Thailand, but we're also looking forward to launch the game in Malaysia and in Singapore the second half of this year. What is it like to work with INE3? You mean how bad we are? So I guess how we are different from other publishing companies is that, first of all, like, there's no question of the experience and our staff. They know where the what's the preference of the gamers are. So I guess a local publisher, this is the point where we are so different from me just buying a CPI and installation. We actually know where the communities are. So in that sense, we can actually help strengthen your communities, right? Your gamer community. And as a result, you should have a longer gaming lifetime, your title lifetime, and also people will stick around and listen to you more than just, you know, download this game and then I go in and I find nobody, and therefore that you leave the game, something like that. So that's one thing that's where we're different as a local publisher. Second thing, in the case of like, maybe a lot of people ask me how is it working with Blizzard, right? So, and people will have a lot of question of what style, what culture. So with Blizzard, with Hearthstone, we have a very different target and objectives, right? They are more focused on organic users. So as a role of local publisher, we need to focus on identifying like who is the real gamer, the real users who's not just download the game and then drop it off or delete it after. And Blizzard has been very keen on knowing who are their players are. As you may know that Hearthstone is just the beginning stage of acquisition. So the game is meant to be for another 10 years time, right? So and that's and with that objective in mind, like we have to design a campaign to really tackle like the local users, like where they are. And recently we just go into school, like high school and university. So that's so just a brief general idea. I think every publisher, every local publisher will also include a service like, oh, we can help you buy in the advertising, the ad networks, this is for sure. Facebook is also one thing, but what's more important for any local publisher, if you talk to them, you need to find out like how good they are in knowing where their gamers is. Mm-hmm.
Just to add, it seems like you have quite a bit of offline activities that you run with communities to get
We do have online. We do have a lot of online, but I leave that out because it's more like a mandatory that every company we're trying to have like weekly activities, right, or a monthly sales campaign. This is a mandatory that every publisher should have. It's quite important. But the adding on, like how do you work? How does it feel like working with Innic3? This is where we're trying to create a more value to our partner. Yeah.
Thank you. Maybe we can move on to TT. TT, what was?
Oh, okay. We currently our headquarters is from Malaysia, so our game currently we are serving for whole Southeast Asia. So we have already published like more than 30 games for the past 2 years. So from the earlier days, we published all the mobile games are based on the separate APK based on languages. That means you have to be a different server from Malaysia, Singapore, and from Thai is another server. But for the 1 year ago, we started to publish to serve the Southeast Asia in one server. Okay, so to become a multi-language APK that to serve across Southeast Asia. So this will be much better for all the gamers, and in terms of retention, they have become more competitive to play along the region. But also we do facing a lot of issues like the language barrier, especially in the chat room. When you are playing a hardcore MMO game or RPG games, a lot of people often like to chat on the chat room. But imagine the chat room, everyone flooded with Tagalog, with Thai, with Vietnam language. So it's really annoying because if you're a Chinese or English users, you see a lot of language that you're not familiar with, you get annoying. So 6 months ago, we tried to make the chat room to become an auto-translate. It means if I'm an English user, whatever things I type inside the chat room, the user from Philippines, they will read as a Tagalog. In Thai, they will read as a Thai language. So it become one language users. So everyone will be like user friendly. They can speak to each other across the region without any language barrier. So far we have also about the sourcing games. Right now, of course, the sourcing games is from mainly China, Korea, and also Japan. And IP is very important as well, because it can help us to bring more organic users, because if the IP is really a well-known IP. So recently, we have preparing for a few games that are going to launch across the regions. We have a few games from Tencent that they have published in China, and we are going to launch a game from Sega, which is a Hortensia Saga, for global. So we're going to launch it in 14 languages. So across the region, but it's exclude Taiwan, Japan, China, and Korea. So for the rest of the country, we will publish this game stages by stages, and started with Thailand, which we already released last week. So we try to make, to serve the whole Southeast Asia with the best solution possible without any language barrier, which is all this while has been an issue for publishing in Southeast Asia. Because unlike other regions, we can simply publish just one language. But in terms of Southeast Asia, if you just want to serve one country, it's not that competitive enough. So we try to serve the user to have more user experience, whatever issue they face in a game, latencies. We try to solve it one by one so that it can serve the whole Southeast Asia, include global as well.
Thank you, Titi. There's something that I want to come back to later once we've heard from Ang and Quang, and that's more about, we both have mentioned working with larger developers, and what is it like for small to mid-size developers that would work with your with you guys, and if you may be able to share any of those experiences, but that's for later. I'll just park that there first, and move on to Ang.
Okay, so our business basically is the same as the Gameview, and we also do the local, the global and regional, and but I think we only have a 10 plus, not until 30. So and we just started the mobile 1 year ago. We also sourced the game from China, and since I joined, we did get the game from the Vietnam developer as well. So that's the strength of the team, is we can try to combine the resources from different countries since we have a local person in the team. What is a good point that you guys, the developer, can work with us? We are not big, we are not very rich, but we can promise we are the most serious publisher in Indonesia, that you hardly can find the better one. And we try to improve ourselves day by day. We also ask the same from the developer. We don't aim for any short-term contract. We don't want to work with the developer that just after a month when the revenue share is not good, then they just stop the support. So once we start the contract, both sides must put into a very high commitment. And that's what we request. We do the same, and we ask the same from the developer as well.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Anne.
We only focus in Vietnam from the day one and until now, and still in Vietnam. So we starting with the distribution. That means we work with thousands of developers and publishers, from individual to indie developer, big studio, small studio, international big corporation, international game like Cut the Rope, for example, to distribute in Vietnam. So Our attitude for us from the day one, we are the startup, so we always serve the customer well, get the money later. That is our first thing we think in mind. And then my team and all of the company following that kind of rule, and we try to do our best to bring the best result for the developer when they give us the game and up to distribute. For example, some developer in Vietnam in the Lunar New Year, they give me the application that is a firecrack, and just hanging on firecrack, and then you send some message to get more money from that, get more crack to fire. So he asked that, can you boost for me 50,000? If I don't have any benefit from that, of course, but we think that if we can help for the user to have fun, and then because they have fun and they will stay with our platform, so we boost for 100,000 install for a week, and then turn out the revenue is very good because everybody want to find the crack in the Lunar New Year with the crack with the phone like that, and they don't mind to spend like $2 or $3. So everybody happy on that. That is the kind of the case we try. We don't know exactly what happened after we do something with a good attitude from beginning. So for until now, for publishing game, I think we publish by ourselves, co-publishing, support people to do publishing in Vietnam, more than 70 game. And that is the old kind of game from Capital, MMORPG, casual, dancing, shooting, whatever, in our platform. So we know a lot of that. But in common, all the developers have the 3 points to working with us. One, we commit to them, they commit to us. That is the first thing. Okay, maybe commit for 1 month or 2 months, just enough. But we still commit, catching the timeline, everything like that. Second, we don't talk about the revenue first, because if you talk the revenue, both sides will be broke, the corporation. Because I don't know, if you give me the game and the platform, in my platform, it's not work. So how can I promise you that I can bring you $50,000 per month or something? I cannot do that. So let's say 2 hours per month, and then we see the data and try to optimize it. Our power is bringing the user, so their power will be like they understand the game, they know how to vampire the user. So that we combine together. The third one is try to more listen to each other. Because doing some game in Vietnam, you need to do localize, customize. And it's not just like bring the whole set in from China or Korea or Western to bring in and they say, hey, and integrate the payment and run it and they say, okay, we earn money. No, it's not work. Somehow you need to change following the event of the year, change the before the culture, because sometimes the pay rate also need to increase by the reduce the exchange rate inside the game. Because you said the price is too high, the user don't pay. Mm-hmm. That is the three things we work with the partner and then try to open as much as we can. And actually we don't mind to work, for example, like today they work with our competitor. The next day they come to us and say, hey Ken Quang, you want to work with us? Fine, open. So we always open for everybody to work with. And somehow if the result is not good, no, let's find another chance to try. So attitude is more important than the result of the business. Because everybody is not just living 1 year. It's growing up and so keep long term for that. That's our focus.
So actually something interesting that Ang and Quang have covered is the commitment from the developers that you would expect, that they would expect from the developers. Maybe Pattera and TT, you can share a bit about what commitment do you expect from developers and probably the mid to smaller size developers. What do you expect from them in terms of support and all that?
Okay, developer. It's very important for them to really have an open mind. So sometimes, so mainly of our game that we source are from China. So many of the experience of developer will be like, why do I need to integrate Facebook login? So they have no idea about it. So it's end up that we have to actually try to educate them as well at the same time. Some of the developer really have a high expectation on market, for example, like they probably read a lot of article, a lot of news that, oh, Thailand and Vietnam is like one of the largest, but the largest in our territory comparing to China were probably different in terms of number. So most of the time we need to manage their expectation as well, right? And other than that, it's the most of the problem that we find with the developer is that they have no idea what is the SDK, like Facebook login integration. Why do we need to do certain kind of things? And sometimes they postpone so many patch, right? It's just because sometimes they're on holiday or something, but they didn't realize that, you know, a little bit of just 1 day delay or 2 days delay would cause us a delay of at least 2 weeks times or to get the app approved by the app store. And as a result, we have to move all the marketing plan that we plan to spend, like, you know, just to accommodate just one, you know, a few days delay, something like that. So that's just kind of hard. But all in all, we understand that the, you know, it doesn't matter if they don't have experience, but as long as they're willing and they're open up for us to tell them this is what you need to do and this is what causes it, then I think it's manageable, right? But if you ask me what was my experience working with them, that's pretty much one of the most painful thing. Yeah. And if you know how to manage, you know, those risks or those miscommunication, chances are you'll get your game launch on time, and then therefore you can avoid a lot of competitor like who's really looking forward to launch the game. And you kind of, you know, we're a publisher, right? We're also friend, we're a competitor, but we're also friends. So we know who's launching what's and what. So we're trying to avoid, like, you know, a face-to-face competition, because it's all like it's always losing, right? Because then people who has the money most is who? The ad network, right? The bidding goes, like, you know. But if possible, we would like to avoid, like, having the same schedule launch. And pretty much it's being determined before with, you know, doing the marketing, planning and everything, right? So yeah, trying to manage the developer to have everything done on time, get them to be very open and explain to them what kind of market environment you are in. That's pretty much.
I just have two more questions. What's the, and the, for everyone else as well, what's the lead time for a developer from when they first start talking to you to when the game gets to market? What's the typical...
It's depending on their experience. Like, we can run as fast as 3 months' time, you know, getting everything ready. Yeah, if they are highly experienced integrating SDK or a lot of apps, things that we need to plug it in, then it's just where it would be very quick. But most of the time, we always find, like, you know, many of the Chinese developers were working with us would be, oh, this is our first time getting out of China.
Yeah.
So that's the hardest part, yeah.
I understand, thank you. So with TT, maybe you can cover a bit of the, from the developer side, what commitment and also what's the lead time like?
Yeah. Okay, I think we deal with a lot of developer before, so I do expect a lot of support from developer. So for new mobile games, I would expect the content to have at least ready 3 months and ahead. Because right now, the mobile game lifespan is very short compared to the old times client games or even web games. If the content is not able to last for more than 3 months, and when you finish the first month and your content is not ready, all your users will be leaving. And you're gonna waste a lot of resources because every single user, mostly you acquired from CPI or whatever things. And also, the support from developer agencies is very important because a lot of developers, sometimes they are from China, from Korea, and even from Japan. And the gameplay might not suitable for the market that we are going to publish. So from time to time, when we test the game before we launch, we might need the game to be amendment, adjustment, to make it balancing, or even the time consuming. Because sometimes when the developer tell you that this game is enough to let gamers to play like for 3 months,
yep.
But this always not happen because don't underestimate the gamers. They can finish your content maybe within 1 month.
Fast, yeah.
So after that, you have no content updates. So this is gonna cause a lot of issue. And most of the time, we don't really talk to nicely with the developer. We have to fight all the time. All the time, you have to fight and get things to be done. I'm asking this to change this and that just to shoot the market. And they always like to ask you the question, if I change, how much revenue do you think you can increase?
Yeah. Yeah.
This is something, yeah. I'm not going to tell them. I have no answer for you. But if you're not going to make the change, the revenue, you're definitely not going to be increased.
Yeah.
At least if you change, we might stand a chance,
yeah.
on this part. So from the game, new game to start launching, it depends on the language, how many languages you are going to serve. If you're talking about one language, if it's already ready, just need to pack with our SDK, you can ready to run anytime. Okay, probably like within 1 month, we can finish everything. If we're talking about multi-language, probably if 4 language to 5 language, we might need to take times around 3 months, 3 months time to prepare. Okay. After all the localizations, and we need to run around of tests to make sure everything is okay. So the developer support actually is so important. They are playing the main role on these parts. Because sometimes when we start launching on first language, for example, this game, we expect like hardcore RPG games from 1 level to 100 level. Okay, the developer think, yes, this can last 2 months. But sometimes within 1 month, the maximum level already hit. So you don't have upcoming content to sustain. So for the next language that we're going to launch, we're going to adjust this part. We're going to make the experience even harder to achieve so that we can estimate the time that can last for the next update to be progressed. If not, then everyone will stuck at the version where you have nothing to do anymore. So in terms of this, we really hope the developer will try to accommodate with the publishers,
yeah.
Because we spend more money on marketing compared to the money that we buy the game from you.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if the game doesn't work well, nobody will win the case.
I understand.
We try to make win-win situation. Everyone hope that the game will do very well, but sometimes there's a lot of things can be happen. So try to just want whatever the support, also 24/7 support.
Yeah.
Okay. Whatever game they have any issue, we also hope that the developer always can do it immediately to solve the issue. We cannot afford any downtime.
Yep.
Okay, in terms of the technical issues. Okay. And also, okay, sometimes developer might have a lot of issue in terms of integrate with the Google, because the China doesn't have any Google. So, you know, we need to implement a lot of like the Google Play services, a lot of enhancement inside. But the China company sometimes they don't understand why you need this and that. Because this is all the requirement by Google. In order, you have to stand a chance to get featured by them. If we are not going to follow all this, so it's kind of hard. Because when the channel will say, okay, send me some how I going to do this? Mm. And you get from Google, it's all in English.
Yeah.
Okay, so for us to solve this issue right now, we build everything inside our SDK.
Okay.
So I will skip this part with the developer. To prevent the unnecessary time consumption for them to study and do this part. So everything will be in our SDK, so that every game coming in, we can implement this one directly without the help from the developer. We do understand this is some issue as well. So if we can settle this issue by ourselves, we will do it.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks.
Marie, that was the common thread between both of you is that you need commitment and flexibility from the developer to support, and for the developer to also budget time to pace out the content within the game and to focus on content delivery after game launch, right?
Usually, nowadays, I will recommend all this content update to be placed in the contract. Talk is useless. Everything in the contract. If they're not able to deliver the next update for me, no payment for you next update also.
Exactly, and the launching time.
So this one is very important. You want money on time, so give me my patch on time as well. So this is what I expected from the developer.
So true, yeah.
Hey, Titi, we should writing a book, Guide to the Developer together, right?
Yeah.
How to work with the publisher.
Because if the developer thinks sometimes, you know, developer always think the publisher have unreasonable demands, but we also expect the developer can serve as well. Because sometimes the developer will say, I have no time for you, I need to serve other country. If you are not ready to serve multiple country, don't sell the game out. Because we cannot afford to lose the users. As a developer, you fully understand, right? So I'm not going to like complain about developer, but this is just an experience for the past 2 years. So we just hope that this is the criteria right now that we really hope the developer can help us try to accommodate. I think Quang and Pattera, they feel the same, right? Everyone feel the same as a publisher nowadays.
You know, as far as my experience goes, it's very rare to have a good developer who's delivered things on time and be very responsible, like the next patch is really on time, and then they do QA. Like, yeah, I run like 10 games, right? There are like only two that can fall in that. So I totally agree with TT that we should put in a contract that if you're not deliver the content, no payment.
I just want to add one more thing from a developer. You know, right now, nowadays, mobile games are like client games. Backend, just take the country, territory is yours, right? So the developer also have to make sure no other partner can do overboard. For example, if you sign for this region, just take this region. Don't take other region and put some Facebook ad on our country and gain. And if you complain to them, you say, I can't do anything, they open themselves. Then I say, okay, let me sign for you Cambodia. Then I open the rest of the country. Is it possible? I sign for Myanmar. How much are you going to sell to me? Then I open the rest of the country. So all these things, I also advise to put in the contract as well. If any happen of the other regions to come into my territory, I will seek for compensation. Yeah, this is very important because it's just a takeaway from the Google backend and Apple backend. And the advertisement is so simple from Google AdWords and Facebook nowadays. And you know, they are very clever nowadays. After you launch the whole territory, they will check from App Annie which grossing you get from the most country. They will target the few country. That's it. So they don't waste the resources on another country. And they after you, okay, after you complain, if the developer doesn't want to take action, there's nothing we can do, right? So this is very important to be stick in the contract as well. I think the developer should really on this seriously.
You can only remember their face. Don't do the business next time.
Anything to add to the words?
Oh no, I just actually my experience of working with the developers, the most comfort one is the one from Vietnam. So I suggest that you guys maybe you can try. The Vietnamese working hard 24/7 and don't cheat on you.
Sometimes it's not about cheating. It's about they just ignore the issue. They thought nothing to do with them. Okay? When this is...
So I add one more thing based on our experience from... Because we work with so many developer and so many Thai platforms they're using to making the product from Unity, Cocos, and whatever, HTML5, even like that. And we work with so many big developers, small studios, so we come up with a niche. Before I talking that I will do this game, I send them the niche. You must check it that. From the SDK, from the local narration, from the timing, from everything from that. And the guideline for everything, and the must, and then the timing for that, the simple timing. Like this week do this week do that. They agree on that, okay, we decide contract. And then we're moving forward for the next step. I introduce my PM, and PM introduce the contractor who following on that and who is doing, who take care of the organization and the contactness for them, everybody working together. They work directly one by one, not in the group. Because in the group, if you talk, another talk, so all pass away, no working. And then we found out it's very effective for us. And then we can able to localize a game with more than 100,000 work from China, and even with image and video, just 1 month for localize SDK, server, everything. And then we had 2 weeks to testing that. Test everything from, because there are so many hack people from the player, hardcore trying to hack every time. We hack ourselves. We hack our server, we hack the game, and we ask the developer to bear with us on that. And they feel, wait, this is so weird. Why these guys, they do so many bad things for the game? Okay, believe me, if it's okay, the first launching day, that will be very okay later. I promise you, if you finish all of this, I will bring enough user, I commit this. And then, okay, we follow you. Then the result is very coming good, and the game very stable for first 3 months. And another thing happened. So we need to planning for update. And they're still busy for many, many other kind, like the country, other region. So what we do is that I send my people directly to go to their office and stay there for 3 days. No nothing to do, wait until they send people to work with us. So that is the kind that we work with. We understand that they are so busy. We understand that everybody has their business with different partner, and everybody can have the, cheat equal. So the way we do, we try to understand them much and keep patient. And then in return, they support us. After that, it's very good. So that is the kind of experience we work with the developer from China. But developer from Japan, they just send the source code. They do nothing. They say, you need something, ask, send me an email for us or a conference and ask. And after the conference, we don't understand it all. So what we do, we find a guy who used to do that version in another country and give us the experience. And then they give the experience very clearly. We easy to ask that my technical to code again the game to making that. But I think that working with the Japan developer is a kind of different style compared to the Korea and compared to the China or compared to the developer from Sarita CISL. So basically, if you have you prepare good enough for everything, that will help the developer as well. Because sometimes they don't know. They actually really don't know. Yeah. So we sympathize for them.
Yes, okay. We will park that one. I think we've covered the overview of what it's like as a developer to work with these publishers. You can also talk to them about different things that they've experienced, like hacks, security, chargebacks, and stuff like that. They have a lot of information for you. All right, so the next part of it is going to be quite fun. So we're going to have them share a case of where you thought it would work out, but it didn't, and why. And also a case where you thought it wouldn't work out, but it did. So maybe at this time we'll start with Quang, and then we'll move down the line. Yes.
Okay, so I will share the case now. We published a football game in 2014. T published for Hosea, and we published for Vietnam market only. So at the beginning, we think that Gil's style and following Mangan style football management game cannot work well in Vietnam. But we see that a lot of people in Vietnam love football, so we try. At that time, we still had amount of money to invest for that, and our platform so strong on not a hardcore user. And that before that, we launched a hardcore game, MMORPG, and the revenue is very good. And we try that type of game because we just love the football. So we don't expect much, and I can earn around like $50,000 per month is very happy for both of us, for all of us, for the CPE, for the agency, and our partner to work with. We all think that. And then we do that with a very slowly from March until the June to launch the game before the World Cup today, 12 June. So I think that the developer so easy, lazy as well. We also lazy. We did nothing. So that's the case. We didn't expect much. But the first day we launched the game, and then we had about 50,000 users got in and the server crashed. So that's so sad. And no payment, but it crashed the server. And then the second day we make it up, and then we know, okay, people are so crazy for this game. So we keep it separate, open more and more server. So in first month, we had 20 server, and the revenue go up to 400K. So that is unexpected for both sides. But it come up another story the second month. The developer see that number, okay, they expect higher number. And then it's reduced 70% compared to the first month because the World Cup gone. But that month is July, and then August is a Premier League. Football from England is open, so it's go up again. Because we add on the betting system inside the game, user can play betting each other for that, and then they compete or not. So that kind of game, casual, social, football, everything that we didn't expect that can earn more money because we do more on hardcore game. But turn out it's very good game for us. And that is the case we didn't expect. The case we expect, but it failed. Okay, I had no friend, but I do game a shooting game, very nice game. We published globally. We had the 3 million download global first. But the monetization of the game, and because it's a shooting game, people go in and play, and they can use their skill. They don't need to top up to stronger than themselves. So they just shooting, go in, shooting 20 minutes, go out, and then gone. So we had 3 million users in the world, and then revenue is very small. Now that's okay. We expect a lot from that, but we didn't see it coming. User, if they go in, if we limited the playing time for them, and they will pay a lot of money for us because they love the game, but it's too late for us until we realize that. So that's okay. But turn out, it's still fine. We had more experience on the project. So it keep going on. Half of my project, we launch again, it failed. But half of them is a success, and some very big success, and some of them very bad, losing. But I'm still thinking that it's the game. For the doing mobile game and publishing, there is so much of thing we cannot expect in ahead, even we planning everything carefully, standard, and I think sometimes we put in many kind of activity we think that's help us a lot in when we launch the game. But turn out, no. Sometimes it's a stupid thing we do, just make the user jumping up. in the Nucky Drawer. Someday we had nothing to do anymore. We just put in the Nucky Drawer in and user top up. $1 can ten times to do Nucky Drawer and then get the item vital inside. And the revenue jump 200%. That is not something, I think that is very good experience and sometimes it's very exciting.
And you.
Hello. So after almost 7 years in Indonesia, I saw a lot of cases that we thought that it worked, but actually it didn't work. And there's nothing that you call success unexpectedly. But okay, I tell you my own experience. When I first came in late 2009, we did research around the market. We went to the cyber cafe and checked the internet speech, the PC spec, and we also understand that Indonesia is very fragmented. The geography, it consists of 17,000 islands, and there is no, you know, the internet is very, very bad. It's, you know, excellent there at that time. I feel like I was put in the jungle at that time because sometimes I was isolated from the world because I cannot connect to the internet. So we thought that the client game would not work because it's very hard to distribute the client. So we also researched that there was almost no web game there. We decided to bring in the web game because all of those reasons above. But when we did the OBT, I remember the CCO at that time was only 1,000, and we expect like 10 times more than that because it is a web game. The team insists on telling me that it's acceptable in Indonesia. I mean, for the first time, it's acceptable. 3,000 CCO already considered success. But after we do more investigation, the result is most of the cyber cafes, they didn't open the browser. No Firefox, no Internet Explorer, no Chrome. So, you know, we were wrong from beginning. We didn't do the very detailed market research. And, you know, then once we already know that, then we have to retarget the user. It must be the home user. But home users, they don't have PC. Officer, how can they play game at office? So that's the case that we felt very hard. The game that we thought that, I didn't think that it is a success unexpectedly, but it is a bigger success than we expect. It's a third game after two game failed. That's my last shot. So if I could not make it, the company will be shut down there. This time, luckily in my team, there was several players from a game that just shut down Indonesia, but not because of the game is going down, but because a conflict between developer and publishers. And I also found out that game is still perform well in the other country, and the supporting team is still doing very well. So I just try to catch that kind of, the chance. I went to Korea myself and tried to talk with the guys. They didn't want to give it to us because they don't trust the Indonesian developer anymore. They said that 2 years, the publisher didn't pay them the revenue share. So so I tried to talk to them a lot and show my very good attitude. I did the approaching for 6 months. At the end, I got the game. And without any kind of promoting the game viral itself because the community already there and it's very loyal. The community is really, really good. And it viral by itself. The market was ready for it. When we just opened the server, the CCU was 3,000. I know it's nothing compared to Vietnam, but in Indonesia, it is like already very like, idle number, dreaming number for us.
Yeah.
And the money comes at once. We don't need to promote anything. It all viral by itself. The company, the community just spread the news and, you know, the success come earlier than we thought. But it is the success, I think, for sure. not unexpected at all. So
so the commitment was to
yeah, we need to look for, but there is that's a chance that like once in a lifetime, I think, because there is, you know, there is no not such kind of game like that in market anymore. Yeah, the old game, but they always keep players, you know, reminding about the old time, the young time, you know, the good memories of their old friends or school. So that kind of strategy is quite good nowadays. Yeah.
Thank you. Titi?
Okay. So when you talk about what we expected to be success, actually I expect all my game to be success. Else I won't sign it at the first place. But sometimes, you know, the rainbow doesn't show up every day. So usually for a game that we sign, we will evaluate among our internal team. So the game that being evaluated the best, of course we feel that that's the most confident game, and it comes from developed by a very reputable developers, and we are putting a lot of hopes for this game. So when we started to run this game, we will give a really high budget of marketing for this game to push to the top in order to gain organic users, everything. But it just end up never turn out as what we expected. And it actually don't do well at all. So after that, we think that, is it the games to be too complicated? Because it's a hardcore MMORPG games that is from the reputable client games developers, and they're shifting everything into the mobile, and the graphic is excellent, everything is good. So from that time, we don't know what went wrong. But as you can see in the market right now, all the top grossing game for mobile, you have to be simple.
Yeah.
It can't be too complicated. Too complicated game, I don't think it can go into top grossing. Okay. So this is one of the game that we really have expect a lot of hope, but end up it never turned out what we expected. And after that, there's another case where the game, we don't expect a lot because based on the evaluation from our internal team, that game is not good. But we, since it's already signed, we need to launch it. So we started with Thailand that time. So we started with Thailand. All my Thailand team was advised, Titi, you shouldn't launch this game. It's not good. Okay. But I can't say this to my CEO, right? He will kill me. So end up we launched, but I put at a very low budget to launch this game.
Yeah.
And the next 2 days later, I saw my game at the top chart without paying a lot of money. Yeah. It just went up. And 2 more days later, I'm in the top 10 grossing. This was really unexpected, and I want to find out why. So I asked a lot of friends from Thailand, can you tell me to test this game? I don't know why my game suddenly makes so much money. So can you tell me why? So after my friends, you know, from other publishing, they play, they said, oh, Didi, this game is similar to one of the client games old days that was really popular in Thailand, maybe like 7 to 8 years ago. And the user base is almost like above 30 years old. So the paying user is so good, they are affordable, and it turned out to be a success. So of course, when this game turned out to be success, I saw a lot of different region publishers inquiry about this game from us for other regions. So, and also we will put more effort on this game on other regions as well, because since we have successful in the first country that we launched in Thailand, so we have confidence. And this shut anyone mouth shut up, because my Thai team, I say, you, the whole team say, you are not, this game cannot make it, because they are too young.
Yeah.
Maybe 10 years ago, they never tried that game yet, but it turned out to be really unexpected. So sometimes, if anyone was asking, how do we forecast a game to be success or not? I don't know. We just try. As long the game is quality, you have enough content, you have the monetizations, it really work well in the game, and probably just try. And I know nowadays a lot of people worry about the user acquisition. It's getting a lot of expensive. And even though you have money, you cannot get users. So there's a lot of issue, but sometimes you just get to the top grossing without spending a lot of money and top chart, and you stay there for like 3 to 4 weeks time. You feel happy, and everyone will like asking, Titi, how much you spend on your CPI? Or you must spend a lot because you stay there for quite long. I said, yeah, spend a lot of money, so you don't do this. So this is just a joke. So, but so far, everyone turns out okay, but this is really unexpected because no one gave a good review on this game before, even myself. I buy it because my CEO love it. Maybe he had a good eyesight on this game.
Maybe he played it in the nostalgia.
My whole company, the one who played the most of the game, is definitely my CEO. He played the game all the time.
Okay.
He play game all the time, 24/7. He play game other than sleeping. He's still playing game.
Got it.
Okay. So we can't turn off our phone. Anything can be 24/7.
So maybe he's a good target profile, you know, for evaluation.
Yeah, for developer, should go directly to the CEO and send all the top ranking level and send, can you test my game? Or there's a lot of developer do that, and they send to me, and I had to test that, play for a while. And then before I tell my team,
because we have a very rules in our company that before this game is launched, we're gonna have all our staff in our office to evaluate the game. Oh. And maybe the whole one day, my CEO will give all the form to every of the staff. Today, everyone no need to work. Just help me to test this game and fill up the evaluation form. So after the day, we'll collect and see everyone's comment. What do you think about this game? But from our own team,
yeah.
The whole company. Even finance, they need to play a game, even they don't play games. Because the CEO doesn't allow you to work today other than playing games.
Okay.
So everyone give a review so that he can have a different point of view from everyone.
Yeah.
So this is already on the final stage. 95% he going to sign the game.
Yeah.
But the 5% is waiting for the final evaluation. Maybe end up he still signed the game, but he just want to get the review of it.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Titi.
Well, I guess this is the beauty of being in gaming industry, right? You always expect the unexpected. And then as far as everyone shared experience, like my experience are pretty much the same, that there's so many things that you thought it would work, and it's always start with good content, right? It's a good developer, it has a huge amount of content, and then therefore everything would be good. But sometimes you really tip your toe, like for example, like the technical didn't pass all of a sudden, there was a huge bug that causes people cannot play your game, or when they get in and then they got kicked out right away and the developer cannot really fix it. Sometimes, you know, you thought that developer know so much about their game, they don't. I mean, when you open the source code, like sometimes like, come on, just open the source code, let us see. No, we cannot, especially from China.
Yeah.
Well, we understand why you don't open it, but at the same times, we're kind of curious, like, oh, you're afraid we're going to see something that you messed up inside, right?
Yeah.
So that's one case. Other than that, like that's my experience from PC as well. So this is a case that happened in like 2004. So that was the first time that we licensed the game, PC game Pangya. It was the free-to-play item selling, right? Probably everybody already know that Nexon is the company that invented the free-to-play item selling models, right? This is the model that really changed the way how we play game. So at that time, it was Ragnarok was very popular in Thailand market. And we were on the verge of closing down our company because we failed so many titles at that time. And we thought, like, okay, whatever, right? We'll just launch it. Just launch Pangya. And it turned out to be like the one very big hit. Like we got 1 million registered users in 3 months' time. So that was something that we really didn't really expect it, right? And at that time, it was another phenomenon after Ragnarok that a lot of media cover. Like, oh, this is a new style, new business model. And
Yeah, at the time I just joined the company. I was very new to the company and was very young, and then I have to deal with a lot of media asking a lot of questions. And of course you know that it is a time when people are really sick and tired of subscription model at that time, and then they wanted to try something new, and then it happened to be that the character was fit for Thai users, and that was the first time that we learned that there are a lot of adults who play the game and didn't want it to share with their children. Yeah. So second one is I mean, there's always ups and downs, and you know, and a lot of expectation that's meet, sometimes didn't meet. In 2009, we launched a first browser game, and we thought it was like, you know, it's really not much in the game, but it turned out to be one of the most successful game from China. It's a strategy game. So this is another one. And then the second title, we know that the market is ready, so we're gonna source like one of the best content whatsoever. But when we launched it, we totally failed with that. So sometimes you don't really, you thought you knew, but you don't. Yeah. But also there are a lot of time when our expectation is like our calculation was just really precise and really correct until I'm really surprised, like how did my team, when we work internally, right? Always when you do the forecast of how much money you're gonna make for this title, it's always off. It's either over or under.
Yeah.
But it's recently, like, I mean, the past year is pretty accurate in terms of mobile game, right? So I would say there are a bunch of up and down, and the only thing that people in our industry, like everyone in the industry, should get yourself ready to learn the new things and make sure that you get enough information, a lot of information, and you know, in the end of the day, it's your judgment that whether you should go for it or not. Like, there were a lot of time when my team say, no, don't publish this title, this is bad, it's really bad. Just go for it, you know, because they see it from a gamer perspective, but I see it from the industry perspective. So somehow you need to take risks, right? And there are also a few titles that they really want to go for it, but I told them, like, you better hold on to this, right? But yeah, we share the mistake, but we also learn the mistake as well.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. So I think right now we'll open up a bit to the. Do we have time for questions? We do.
We don't have time. Right?
No time. Oh, okay, we have no time for questions. So we'll catch. Thank you so much for sharing your stories and perspective. You can catch them after this, and thank you so much for this panel. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.